Welcome to Run Jump Stomp, a podcast about games, because we needed another. You can find the show notes for this episode, as well as other content at runjumpstomp.com. This is episode number 35 for the week of October 11th, 2015. I'm Bill, your host, and this week, we'll be talking about the possibility of a voice actor strike. Valve steps in. We shouldn't be expecting another handheld from Sony anytime soon. Those stories, plus more, on this episode of Run, Jump, Stomp. Thanks for listening. So back in 2007, 2008, and I don't actually remember the year for this, but it was somewhere in the 2007, 2008 range. My wife and I were watching a show. It was, what was the name of the show? It was about a guy who had the ability... it was called Pushing Daisies. So this guy, he had a magical ability, basically, in order to touch somebody who was dead, and they would live until he touched them again. And it was one of the best written shows with really bizarre characters that were very, very interesting. And then the writer's strike happened, and that show never recovered. So I don't really know the details of the writer's strike back when it happened. But all I know is that really good shows, they didn't end up continuing because people weren't there to write the stories. And so they everything just kind of got swept under the carpet and we had to start over. And I'm worried because I think that that might happen again. The reason I bring all that up, because, I mean, what's that have to do with video games, is because the Screen Actors Guild, which is basically, if you're an actor, you have to be in the in SAG. They announced that they have voted to strike. 96.52% of the members voting were in favor of the Interactive Media Agreement strike authorization referendum. Oh my goodness. And does that spell anything? I-M-A-S-A-R. I'm a SAR. Okay. I'm a SAR, whatever. Basically what this does, it doesn't mean that the voice actors are actually on strike yet. It just means that when the national board, which is these are the people who are negotiating with video game companies, it gives them the right to say, you know what, if you don't listen to us, we can go on strike. So they haven't actually done this yet, but the National Board is in negotiations with publishers like Electronic Arts, Activision, Disney, Warner Brothers, all those guys, in order to get better treatment or better working conditions for SAG actors when they come and work on video games. And the current talks have kind of broken down. So the National Board went back and they said, all right, we need to do a SAG vote. And the actors who voted, a ridiculously high amount of them, have said, yes, you have the right to put us on strike if you don't get the treatment that we're asking for. So let's talk about what they're asking for. Most people would call what they're asking for residuals or secondary payments or like royalties, whatever it is that you want to call it. And this is a quote. It's simply the idea that if a video game is wildly successful, actors should share in its financial success. There is ample precedent for residual income for actors, yet they've historically been extremely difficult to achieve in this contract. The formula that they propose is as follows, and then they go into the math behind it, which if you want to read that, you can check out the link in the show notes. They said, in addition, the union is proposing that the new agreement tackles a concern for vocal stress. That is a proposal for a two-hour limit on the vocally stressful recording sessions. So if you've ever watched a like a behind the scenes of a game, and they show the voice actors, they're usually in a booth screaming, because, and you know, let's say that you're not filming, but let's say you're shooting or making a game that's like, I don't know, a war game, and you need your general on the battlefield to be telling people to, you know, do this or do that. Well, they have to record lots and lots of different lines because the developer doesn't know what the player is going to be doing. And they don't want to just have one line. So they want to have a bunch of lines to pull from. So the actors have lots of lines to record that we may never even hear. And if you're spending all day screaming, it's going to be difficult. It's going to be rough on your voice. And so basically they're saying, look, when you have a session that is a vocally stressful section of recording, then we need to limit that to 2 hours. And I think that's more than fair. The way I look at it, they're not asking for crazy demands. They're not being ridiculous. They're just asking for treatment that I think that they deserve. Especially when the games, they tout these actors. They're like, hey, look, I don't remember which one it was. It was Call of Duty or Modern Warfare or one of those shooter games that I don't really play. But they're like, look, we got Kevin Spacey. You know, they're saying, look at how awesome it is that we have these great voice actors. I was on the Inverted Aim podcast yesterday, and we were talking about they got Gary Oldman and Mark Hamill and somebody, Gillian Anderson. So they got those three big actors for some game. I don't remember which game it was. And they were like, hey, look at this. We got a big deal. So if they are saying that, hey, these actors are a big deal, then they need to be treated like they're a big deal. And those actors should be paid accordingly. That's how I look at it anyway. So if the game does really well, then they should be paid more. If the game does crap, then they should be paid the minimum. That's how it should work. That's how it works in acting, at least as far as I know. Again, I'm no actor. Although, hey, if anybody wants to listen, wants to have me do some voice acting, I can do, you know, I can do what I can. I talk like this. Anyway, I hope that when these publishers have their meeting, they don't stonewall the national board, because I don't want to see a strike cripple the video game industry. Although this would be really good for indie games who have almost no voice acting most of the time. This next story is my favorite story of the week, and that's because it's showing a video game company doing the right thing. Valve, who continues to be a mystery to me. Sometimes they're like the best, and then other times they're like the worst, and you can't figure out what are these guys thinking. Sometimes they're just so all over the place with their policies. Well, there's a game, and this is actually a little old news, but I didn't, like, last week's show went a little too long, so I cut this, and I still wanted to talk about it because I thought it was important and awesome. There's a game on Steam called Epic Quest of the Four Crystals, and Valve, an employee at Valve named TOMG, which is gotta be, his name's gotta be Tom, and he's changing it to Tom, oh my god, but that's funny. Anyway, this Valve employee posted on the Steam site, it said, it has come to our attention that Aldoria Games, that's hard to say, and Rose Portal Games have given gifts or otherwise compensated some Steam customers in order to get them to leave reviews for the game Epic Quest of the Four Crystals. This is a manipulation of the user review system, which we won't allow. Unfortunately, we cannot tell which reviews were manipulated in this way. To preserve the integrity of the user reviews on the product, we're deleting all reviews to date. If you wish to repost your review, we welcome you to do so. We've emailed all affected customers and included a copy of their user review. So first off, this is awesome. When companies do horse hockey like this, things to get around the system in order to trick people into buying a crappy product, and they get called on it, that's when, you know, the good guys win. And by good guys, I'm saying consumers. That's when we win. We win when companies don't get to do stuff like this. So most of the time, customers do not get to win. It used to be a long, long time ago in a galaxy. Well, okay, in this galaxy, it used to be that the customer was always right. And more often than not, today, it's the customer is a windbag and we can do whatever we want and nobody cares. And that's not how it works. That's not how it should work anyway. And so I'm really happy to see Valve doing the right thing here. I like to see that they are clamping down and keeping companies from ripping us off. You know, so let's look at the good things that Valve has done recently. They started allowing people to return games. If you think about the Batman situation with the newest Arkham game, a lot of companies allowed people to return that Batman game. Well, a lot of companies. The companies that you could buy it from. There's like really only two or three. Okay? But the companies that would allow you to buy that game on the PC were allowing returns. And I guarantee that the only reason they were is because Valve was. Valve got out there in the front and they said, listen, this is not how you treat customers. Let people return bad games. And it just so happened that that policy came out right about at the same time that the new Arkham game came out. So the new Arkham game ends up getting returned because it was a buggy piece of crap. Now, to be fair, I've heard on console it's fantastic, so I'm not trying to throw it under the bus, just the PC port was really, really bad. I've heard that they're almost done fixing it, and that it's supposed to be really good once it comes out again. So time will tell. I'll wait for it to come on sale, though. Then they did this. This is also awesome. But as cool as this is, I don't think that Valve is doing enough. Because I've also seen companies abuse the review system by taking a game that has generally negative reviews and putting it into a bundle by itself. I forget the name of the company that did it. Was it Konami? I think it was a soccer game. And I talked about it on the podcast when it was discovered, but I think it was Konami. And if it's not, you know, let me know. And then I'm very sorry, Konami, if I threw you under the bus, but I think I'm right. So it was like some kind of soccer game, and basically they made it, this game had bad reviews on Steam. It was generally negative. And so what they did is they put it into a bundle all by itself. So basically the bundle was the same price as the regular game. And then the bundle doesn't show the reviews of the games in it. So people would buy it, not knowing that it was poorly reviewed, because they didn't see that it was poorly reviewed. You know, that's one thing where Valve didn't go far enough. So, Valve, good on you for fixing this user review thing, but you've got a long way to go, and I really hope that they fix this, because they even said this on their site. They said, advertising laws in many countries require you to disclose any compensation for your review. So these people were selling their review, and that's not cool. So like I said a little bit ago, last week's show was too long, so I had to cut some stuff in order to keep it from getting out of control. But I still wanted to address this, and that is Sony. My brain is not working. Shuhei Yoshida, the president of the Sony Computer Entertainment Worldwide Studios, he was talking to Tom Phillips, who works at Eurogamer, and they were talking about the Vita. And he said, when he was asked, are we going to see a successor to the Vita? And he said, well, that's a tough question. He said, people have mobile phones, and it's so easy to play games on smartphones. And many games on smartphones are free or free to start. He says, I myself am a huge fan of the PS Vita, and we worked really hard on designing every aspect. Touch-based games are fun. There are many games with really good design, but having sticks and buttons really makes things totally different. So I'm going to pause here for a second. I'll go back to his quotes after. I totally agree with what he says. Every time that I grab my phone and I go to the App Store and I download a game that looks really cool, I enjoy it for a little tiny bit, and then I get bored. It's just not as fun, or I don't like having my fingers in the way when I'm trying to play a game. So I can see why sometimes touchscreen games are pretty cool, but for the most part, I think that they're a mistake. Or maybe it's because they're making these games and nobody will buy them if they're $15, so they make cheap, crappy games. Maybe if people were more willing to spend money on games for your phone, then those games would be better. I mean, think about it. People will go out and buy a $5 cup of coffee without blinking, yet they will not turn around and buy a game off the App Store for 99 cents. Or if it's more than 99 cents, they'll say, are you kidding me? I'm not spending $3 on a game. That's blasphemous to them. I don't understand this thinking, but that's just me. I mean, I've been paying for games my whole life. So I agree that touchscreen games are fun, but there's also something to be said for having those buttons. You got to be able to feel the buttons under your fingers when you're playing. It really makes, or thumbs, I mean, it really makes playing the game a lot better and more enjoyable. And plus, I don't like, and I said this just a few minutes ago, but I don't like when my fingers are covering the screen. So, you know, there's reasons why touchscreen only games, you know, there's definitely issues there. So then he said, so I hope, like many of you, that this culture of playing portable games continues, but right now the climate is not healthy because the huge dominance of mobile gaming. So he didn't come out and say, listen, we're not going to have another Vita. He just said, right now, the competition is too stiff. I mean, the Vita got trounced by the 3DS, and even the 3DS had a really rough start. Nintendo brought out the 3DS. It was way too expensive. People didn't buy it, so they lowered the price, and it sold like crazy. Like, they've done really well on the 3DS. Now, the Vita, which I would definitely say is a more powerful system, has a better build quality, without a doubt. It just did not sell as well as the 3DS. And I'm not positive why that is, but I think part of it is Sony has always had, and I could be wrong because I don't have a Vita, but I think that they used like proprietary storage, so you could only buy memory cards from Sony, and they were ridiculously expensive. Like, that kind of predatory licensing, I guess is the word that I'm looking for. I don't like that, and it makes me feel kind of creepy. I don't like it makes my skin crawl. I don't like the way it makes me feel when I buy something and they're like, well, you can only use storage that we approve, because there's no reason for it other than they're just trying to bilk me. Do you think that we're going to see another Vita, or at least a successor or an upgrade to the Vita? I really don't see one coming down the line. Even Nintendo is saying, listen, we're going to start making mobile games. You know, a lot of game companies they're giving up on the portable space. Now, do we think the portable space for dedicated handheld will go away? While I don't think Sony's going to take another crack at it, I do think Nintendo's going to take another crack at it. I think that Nintendo is going to make another portable, and this is my prediction. A lot of people have said this, though, that Nintendo's next system, the NX, is actually going to be a portable system that lets you play it on the TV. Think of it like this. The Wii U is a system that you hook up to the TV, and then you can play it with the TV off by wirelessly sending the image from the TV to the controller. What if it was set up to go the other way? What if the NX was a portable system, hopefully with only one screen, and you could... It came with a box that plugged into the HDMI port on your TV that let you play the games on the NX up on the TV. And then when you were done, you could take it with you and play it someplace else. That seems like a really compelling product to me. It would not compete directly with Microsoft or Sony, but it'd be really cool. And I think it would sell really well, too. So I don't know if portable gaming is going anywhere. I don't know if mobile gaming is going to completely squeeze it out, but I'm pretty sure that Sony is not going to be making a successor to the Vita, even if their CEO didn't come out and say it. Anybody that listens to the show knows how I feel about exclusivity. I hate exclusivity. It ticks me off when there's something that is clearly able to be played on my system. I can't play it on my system because of business deals. I don't like that stuff. Which is why I'm pretty happy about this next story. And again, this is a little bit older. Last week was really long. But Hype Train Choo Choo posted on Twitter. He was asking Pete Hines, who works on Fallout 4. He said, will DLC come to Xbox One first, or will they release about the same time? So what this guy's asking basically is, look, we all know that Fallout 4 is a multi-platform game. Yay for Bethesda. Good job, guys. But what we're used to having happen to us is where the DLC, downloadable content, for a game is exclusive to one console over another, making it hard to buy the game for the console of your choice if they didn't make a deal with the company. And Pete Hines' response was awesome. He said, we aren't doing a DLC exclusive with anyone. That's great. That means no matter where you decide to buy your copy of Fallout 4, and I am really looking forward to Fallout 4, which comes out next month. Man, I forgot that it was coming out that soon. That's very exciting. So Fallout 4 coming out next month, when the DLC hits, everybody gets it. It's not just for the people who bought the right console 2 years ago. It's for whoever bought the game on whatever platform that you decided to play it on. I will be playing it on Steam. I'll be playing it on my PC because I don't have an Xbox One. I don't have a PS4. Although, the PS4 is looking really, really attractive to me. They've got some games coming. I don't want to diverge here. But the PS4 is calling to me, especially with that price drop. So he said they're not doing a DLC exclusive with anyone. I love this, although it wouldn't probably affect me anyway. And here's why. I play a lot of games. I don't finish a lot of games. And huge, epic, open-world games, I almost never finish those. I didn't finish Oblivion. I didn't finish Skyrim. Hell, I bought Skyrim twice. I bought it on the Xbox 360. I bought it on the PC. I bought Oblivion twice. I bought that on the Xbox 360, and I bought it on the PC. And even though I bought both of those games twice, I still Didn't finish either one. I had lots of fun with both of them, and I poured many, many hours into Skyrim, especially more than Oblivion, because Skyrim was, you know, head and shoulders above Oblivion. Well, that's funny. I'm talking about a bunch of Bethesda games. Fallout 3, I finished. I did finish that game. I wouldn't say that I did not 100% it, but I did finish the main story. And I loved it. It was great. Fallout New Vegas, I own it on Steam because I got it when there was like some huge sale, but I haven't even played it yet. And Fallout 4, when it comes out, I'm going to play it. I highly doubt that I'll finish it, but I will play it and I will enjoy it. Now, because I don't finish a lot of games, I tend not to buy DLC for games. I almost never do. The exception would be games like Mario Kart. I bought the DLC for Mario Kart because, you know, more courses to race on. That's the kind of game where I would play that. But usually when I'm playing like a single player game, even when they add DLC, once I finish the game, I tend not to go back to it. There's a buddy of mine. He'll go back and play a game over and over and over again. And I just can't do that. Once I've learned the story, I'm done with it and I can move on. But, you know, that's just me. So there's a lot of people out there who like DLC. They like to be able to go back to the world that they were playing in and check out the new stuff that's added. That's not me, but I'm really glad that anybody who buys Fallout 4 will have the opportunity to get the DLC without having to wait for some ridiculous exclusivity clause to run out. So good on you, Bethesda. Good job. Deus Ex Mankind Divided had this weird pre-order system where it was called Augment Your Pre-Order. I talked about it. I kind of ranted about it when it first came out. There's in an old episode. I can't remember which episode, but if you just want to find my rant about the Augment Your Pre-Order thing, you can go to my YouTube channel. And I bet you if you typed in Deus Ex in the search in the search under my YouTube channel, you'd probably find my rant there because I posted it there. But Deus Ex, Mankind Divided, they had this system for pre-ordering. And the way that it worked was the more people that pre-ordered the game, the higher that the bar would fill up. And at certain points when the counter bar hit certain points on it, it would unlock new choices for people to make. So let's say that, and I'm just making up numbers here. They never came out and said what the numbers would be. So let's say after 100,000 pre-orders, it would unlock level 2, and you'd be able to pick 2 level 2 items for your pre-order. You know, like a coat or sunglasses for your character. Then, after 150,000, that unlocks level 3. Again, I'm just making up stuff. At level 3, everybody gets a certain thing. So, basically, what this was doing is it was trying to get people to pre-order the game and then get the people who pre-ordered the game to try and get other people to pre-order the game so that they could get the stuff that they actually paid for. People were really unhappy about this, and I ranted about it big time, and I'm really happy to say that Square Enix, they listened, and they said they're shutting down the Augment Your Pre-Order nonsense. So I'm happy that they did that. Now, when I go to the site, it says Deus Ex Mankind Divided, shutting down Augment Your Pre-Order, find out more. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna find out more. So I click on it, nothing happens. So I'm not really sure, like, does everybody who pre-ordered get all of the stuff that you were going to have to choose between? One of the things was if you get to level 5 on the pre-order list, that they were going to release the game 4 days early, which is ridiculous because they were just going to release it 4 days early anyway. I think that they said, you know what, we're just going to release it those 4 days early. But really, I mean, who cares about, it's 4 days, guys. 4 days. You can't wait 4 days. It's less than a work week. Why can't people just wait? Just relax and wait. There's things that I'm excited about, too. I'm excited for my Steam controller to get here, and it's not here yet. And dang it, I want it now. And if I could get it 4 days earlier, I'd probably be really happy about that. But I don't see Steam going around and saying, hey, we'll ship your stuff 4 days early. If you call up your friends and tweet them and tell them, hey, you got to pre-order this controller. You know, it just seems, I don't know, like a used car salesman. It's very sleazy. So I'm, and to the used car salesmen out there, I wasn't talking about you. I was talking about some other used car salesman. So anyway, Square Enix shut that down, which is good because it was making a game, which is probably going to be a good game because the last Deus Ex game was a good game. It was giving it bad press and it was making it look like, hey, this game can't stand on its own 2 feet. So we have to resort to gimmicks to get this on the shelves, or not on the shelves, it's probably digital only. Well, it's digital only on PC. But in order to get the game to sell, it felt like they were resorting to gimmicks, which tells me that they're not confident about their game. If your game is good, you don't have to resort to gimmicks to get it to sell. You just let people play it. And people will say, holy cats, have you played Deus? They probably won't say holy cats. That's something that I say. Oh my goodness, have you played Deus Ex, Mankind Divided? It's the greatest game ever. You cannot put that on the back of your box. I'm being hyperbolic here. So it's the greatest game ever. Go buy it right now. And people would go out and buy it. They don't need a gimmick to sell the game if the game is good. So when a company resorts to a gimmick, it makes people like me, and hopefully people like you, think, you know what? Maybe this game isn't all that great if they're resorting to gimmicks to try and get me to buy it. Anyway, I feel like I'm ranting against these guys when they finally did it right. I guess I'm just still irritated that they did it at all. This week on the wish list, I'm adding a racing game, which most of the time, not really my thing. I mean, Mario Kart, I love. I'm having a blast on Rocket League, but that's not really a racing game. And I was always a fan of F-Zero, but I'm putting another racing game on my list, and that is Distance. Now, it's an early access game, so I'm not going to say go out and get it, and I have not played it. But on Steam, it's got overwhelmingly positive reviews, so that's really great. They say Distance is a survival racing game that combines the intense action of arcade racing. I love arcade racing. I don't like simulation racing. With the exploration of an atmospheric world. And definitely, if you watch the video, there's a link, of course. If you watch the video, it definitely has an atmospheric vibe to it. It looks really dark with extremely bright neon colors in the screen. Looks really, really great. It says you control a unique car that allows you to boost, jump, rotate, and even fly through a chaotic, twisted city. Now, like I said, that this is an early access game. So they have an answer to a few questions. It says, why early access? They said, we think early access is a great avenue for us to continue to iterate on Distance with new players the same way that we've been doing it since we released our private alpha to Kickstarter backers back in 2013. So this game has been in development for a while. They said, how long will this game be in early access? They said that the final version is supposed to come out in 2016, so probably 12 to 18 months. Now, I'm not sure when this was originally released, December 9th, 2014. So this has been an early access game since December, so almost a year now. They said 12 to 18 months, so, you know, I guess that's fair. They said, how is the full version planned to differ? The adventure mode will have more content as well as more fleshed out story. So they're actually going to put in a fleshed out story. Although this game, most of the time when you hear me talk about how I really like single player games. This is the type of game where I really don't care about the story too much. Now, I might enjoy it. I'm not saying don't try the story. It's just probably everybody's going to be racing, and that's why you play a game like this, is to play against the other people. It says the multiplayer experience is going to be updated based on feedback received from the community, and it has a level editor, which sounds really cool. So if you watch the video, the sound just came on. You can see fantastic graphics. It looks really, really cool. The cars look really flat. I like that on the top of each car, it shows what place they're in. So there's no interface covering the game. All of the information that you need is shown to you on the roof of the car, which is really, really cool. And, like, it's got this really cool Blade Runner-looking city with extremely bright neon colors. And I just saw, like, this really cool thing. There were these lasers, and the car drove through the laser. The laser cut the car in half. And then they're driving up on walls and flipping around and doing really cool stuff. And now they're showing the level editor. So this has some really cool ideas behind it. And I can definitely see losing a lot of hours to distance. Let's see, how much is it? It is currently $19.99 on Steam. And that's early access. Now, I tend to shy away from early access games. Something really has to catch my eye before I will try an early access game, even though the last game that I talked about was early access. So Distance is an early access game. If you think that you trust them enough to finish it, then by all means, it's $20. You know, that's a good deal. But I'm going to be waiting until the game is done. All right, everybody, that is it for the show this week. If you want to support the show, you can do so by giving me a review on iTunes. I'd love to get that feedback from you. Let me know what you think of the show. If you want to be part of the show, you can email me. That's runjumpstomp@gmail.com. Or you can call in. That's 260-RUN-JUMP. That's 260-786-5867. You can also find me on Twitter, Twitch, and YouTube at runjumpstomp. As always, thanks for listening. But before you go, I want to thank Ben from the Inverted Aim podcast. He had me on to talk about some video games, and we had a lot of fun. It turned out to be a really long episode, and we talked about a lot of stuff. So if you want to know what a laser mammoth is, I suggest you check it out. There will be a link in the show notes. Alongside that link is also going to be a link in the show notes to SevCon by Big Giant Circles. It is the song that I'm going to be leaving you with today. Thanks again for listening, and have an awesome day.